one question that many people ask is that why God is allowing so much sufferings on this earth? If God is a good God, if God is a perfect understanding God, then why God is allowing us to pass through many sufferings? Why there are so much of pain and sufferings and wars and disasters and natural calamities on this earth like that? Of course, we can say that this is a sin-cursed earth, and with Jesus coming, there will be new heavens and the new earth, and there is a new realm of life. But the question remains, why God is allowing us to pass through all these things today? And to find an answer to that, we have to say that God is using all these uncertainties and the lack of safety and uncertainties and insecurities of this world to help us to turn to Him. You know, when any person passes through any sufferings or problems in his life, he can either humble himself before the God Almighty, or he can harden himself. We have a choice. Hebrews 3:8 and 15 says that today if you hear God's voice, do not harden your heart. But rather, when we are going through these problems, if we can be aware of some higher realm than we have ever experienced. Like, you know, when all this earth is very unsafe and uncertain and insecure, we tend to think of an eternal realm where there is the real rest, where there is a real peace, where we can enjoy the real love and fullness, where there is a real satisfaction and fulfillment of our life. So God is turning the tables of Satan against himself. You know, of course, sin and the devil and the fall of earth and everything has caused all these problems, but God is using all that to achieve His own end. He is a sovereign God, He is a sovereign controller of everything that happens on this earth, especially in each one of our lives. He has numbered the hairs of our head. So when we pass through these things, the Lord expects us to humble ourselves and seek Him. Acts 17:26, one verse is there where it says that God has predetermined our boundaries of our habitations, our times and habitations. The Lord has already destined so that within those boundaries we need to humble ourselves and seek Him and find Him. I'll read that verse to you. Acts 17:26 says that God made from one man every nation of mankind to live on all the face of the earth, having determined the appointed times and boundaries of their habitation. Which time, which century, which year we need to be born, which year we are going to pass away, everything the Lord has already determined. And the boundaries of a habitation, which part of the earth, which part of India or Kerala, wherever, God has already determined that. Acts 17:27, that they would see God. The Lord's desire is that that within the boundaries God has kept us, that we should seek Him. And if perhaps they might grope for Him and find Him, though He is not far from each one of us. Like a man of God said, when we are in the hospital bed, with all the tubes and all the four limbs, the only direction that we can look is upwards. Like that, when we are stricken with so many problems and sufferings on this earth, of course that is for a little while. 1 Peter 5 is a great chapter in this regard, where it says that, verse 10, after you have suffered for a little while, 1 Peter chapter 5 verse 10, after you have suffered for a little while, God of all grace, who called you to His eternal glory in Christ, will Himself perfect, confirm and strengthen and establish you. So after you have suffered for a little while. And the verse 9 also, it says that the same experiences of suffering are being accomplished by your brethren who are in the world. 1 Corinthians 10:13 says that no temptation has overtaken you, but success is common for man. God is faithful, who will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you are able to bear, and with each temptation He will allow a way of escape. 1 Corinthians 10:13. So that means He will not allow us to be tempted beyond what we are able to bear, and no temptation has overtaken you which is not common for man. Actually whatever we are, the same thing we read here also, 1 Peter 5:9, the same experiences of suffering are being accomplished by a brethren who are in the world. So don't pity yourself saying that, oh, I am the only person who is going through all this, because there are many other people who are going through worse sufferings, who have gone through worse sufferings also. So, and also, you know, I was telling about this 1 Peter 5, where it says that, you know, I said the Lord wants us to humble ourselves before Him and seek Him and find Him in this suffering. What I have found in what the Lord has taught in my own life is that through many adversities and many problems and challenges in my own life, the Lord has broken the strong self-will of mine and broken that strength of my own will and my own self-strength, so that I can be humble before Him and I can receive more of His grace, the power of the Holy Spirit. That is what we read in 1 Peter 5:5, the latter part. 1 Peter 5:5, God is opposed to the proud but gives grace to the humble. Therefore, verse 6, therefore humble yourself under the mighty hand of God, that He may exalt you at the proper time. That has become one of my favorite verses now. Humble yourself under the mighty hand of God. The mighty hand of God would be in many circumstances God allows in our life. Some difficult persons that we come across in our lives. Or it can be failures in our own lives. Or it can be some mistakes that we have committed in the past, knowingly or unknowingly. Or it can be some misconceptions. It can be our own misunderstanding about some things, about some circumstances and all, that would be causing some stress and all. So I was telling about problems through persons, through circumstances, through our own failures, through mistakes or misconceptions. So all these things, when you are going through all those things, see the mighty hand of God in everything and humble yourself there and be a zero before the Lord and say that, Lord, I acknowledge that I am nothing, and Lord, you are the sovereign controller. Everything, without your knowledge and permission, nothing can happen in my life. You have even numbered the hairs of my head, Luke 12:7. If we humble ourselves like that, He will give us the grace. Grace is the power of the Holy Spirit. My grace is sufficient for you, for my power is perfected in weakness. 2 Corinthians 12:9-10. So when we are weak, then we are strong. That is what 2 Corinthians 12:10 Paul says. Paul had this thorn in the flesh, probably some disease or something in his eyes, as we can infer from Galatians 4. So that was not healed at all, although he was used mightily by God to heal many people and to raise even dead people. His own ailment was not healed, and it was kind of a thorn in the flesh to keep himself from exalting himself, to keep him humble. If you turn with me, keeping a finger here in 1 Peter 5:6, if you turn with me to 2 Corinthians chapter 12, the last chapter of 2 Corinthians 12, verse 9 and 10. My grace is sufficient for you. You know the context. Paul is having this thorn in the flesh. He is entreating the Lord many times. We read that from verse 7 onwards. And God's answer, Jesus' answer to him is, my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is perfected in weakness. When we are weak, then only the Lord can really fill us with His power. When we are weak in ourselves, when we are weak in our own self-strength, when we are broken in that strong, soulish power, when we are broken there, then the Lord can give His power, more and more of His power of the Holy Spirit. So then he says, most gladly, I will rather boast about my weaknesses so that the power of Christ may dwell on me. It is like that word episkeno is used over there, the Greek word, which means like dwelling on a tabernacle, episkeno. Skeno is the word for tabernacle. Episkeno is a related word where it is like the power of Christ will be dwelling on me, like the glory in the most holy place in the tabernacle rested. The glory of God rested in the most holy place in the tabernacle. The power of God, the power of the Holy Spirit, His grace, His power will be resting upon me. So that's why God is loving that. Then he says in verse 10 that I am well content with weaknesses, insults, distresses, persecutions, with difficulties for Christ's sake. For when I am weak, then I am strong. And why the Lord is allowing that? He says in verse 7, because of the surpassing greatness of the revelation, for this reason, to keep me from exalting myself, there was given me a thorn in the flesh, a messenger of Satan to torment me, to keep me from exalting myself. Two times he says in the same verse, verse 7, to keep me from exalting myself. So, for unbelievers, of course, you know, only if you humble yourself and acknowledge that Christ is the only way for salvation, for the forgiveness of sins, you can be saved. So that's why even for a person who is not knowing Christ, the Lord is allowing some sufferings, so that even in that he can humble himself and find Christ. And there is crisis, Christ only can help, people will understand. And even for a believer, even for a child of God, why God is allowing sufferings? Because actually, even all through that, if we learn to humble ourselves, of course we have the choice. Of course we know of many people who have been hardened through sufferings also. That is unfortunate, those who have lost their faith, those who fall away from faith and all are there. But of course, history of Christianity says about many saints of God. And one thing for sure is that all the real saints of God have passed through real sufferings, real persecution, real opposition, real torture in their life. Because of all that, only they could really be broken by the Lord and could be really blessed and used by the Lord. One example I remember is of Madame Guyon, who was a really saintly woman in the 17th century, in the early years of Reformation. In Paris she lived, and there was so much of opposition from her own house, from her own husband, from the mother-in-law, from the housemaid, and even from the Roman Catholic Church she was part of. She was even jailed for her faith, for standing up for the Lord and all. And but actually, if you read her writings, which are freely available in the internet and all, Madame Guyon, Madame Jean Guyon, and actually how precious are her experiences of union with the Lord, and how she deeply experienced Christ's presence, and how she had such revelations on the way of the cross, which even many people with so much of Bible knowledge today doesn't have. So why God is allowing this suffering? So that we can be broken, we can be humbled, so that we can receive the grace of the Lord. And coming back to, I told you to keep a finger in 1 Peter 5:5. Why? Because we read till verse 6, then says verse 7. Verse 7, everybody knows, cast your cares on the Lord because He cares for you. But before that, it says that to really cast your cares unto the Lord, we need to humble ourselves. Otherwise, we will be trying to cast all cares, but nothing will be cast on to the Lord. It will be coming back to us. But we humble ourselves and say that, Lord, I'm just nothing. I'm just a zero. If you take that position before the Lord, that Lord, I'm just nothing and nobody, then actually you can really cast all your cares onto the Lord. You can really humble yourself and surrender yourself before the Lord as a living sacrifice. And the fire of heaven, the spirit of care and the spirit of strength and power will come upon you. There it says, casting all your anxiety on Him because He cares for you. Then you will be able to experience His care. Why I said spirit of care, is spirit of His, we will be able to experience the Lord's care and His touch and His comfort. We can really experience if we really humble ourselves and cast all our cares unto the Lord. And even 1 Peter, the same page, perhaps in 4th chapter, some verses before, it says, verse 14, if you are reviled for the name of Christ, you are blessed, because the Spirit of glory and of God rests on you. When you are going through all that, the Spirit of God, when you are reviled for Christ's sake, when you are going sufferings, whether it is for Christ's sake or even God is allowing some crisis in your life, when you go through that, the Lord will shower His grace, His Holy Spirit, the power of the Holy Spirit upon your life, and will be broken, your self will be broken, and you will have a deeper personal fellowship with the Lord. I can testify that from my own life, from what all sufferings, whatever, you know, I come to the Lord from a non-Christian background, from a Hindu background. I had to face much opposition from my parents and relatives in the initial years, not now anyway, by the Lord's grace. And of course, even ridicule and isolation from the friends and so many misunderstanding and so many things that the Lord took me through, I can say, over these years, some 20 and a half years since I have known the Lord. And I can say that through all those sufferings, through all those persecution, I could really know the Lord a little more deeper. The revelation of the person of the Lord Jesus, which I could not have known otherwise, the Lord, I can say, that revealed to me when I went through this some pain and suffering and all. That is the time when we can humble ourselves and know that the Lord is real and His comfort is so real than any human being can ever comfort us. So when we are entering into that deeper fellowship with the Lord, what will happen? We will become more like Christ, and then we will be able to comfort many others who are downtrodden. We will be able to comfort and care for many people. The Lord is, taking us through suffering so that we can have a ministry for many other people who are suffering. When we say comforting word to a person who is suffering, it will be from our own life. It will be from the comfort which we have received from the Lord when we went through some affliction. 2 Corinthians 1:3-4, Paul is telling that God is a God of all comforts, and He comforts us in our afflictions, so that with that same comfort we can comfort those who are going through similar afflictions. So the real ministry of the new covenant comes out from a life which is filled with the comfort of God and which is overflowing with the comfort of God. And so for us to be an example for many other people, the Lord takes us through some suffering so that we can tell them from our own life experiences how the Lord comforted us and how the Lord strengthened us.